I guess we'll call the meeting to order. You gotta, everybody take a look at the last minutes. Did you do the minutes of that first yet?
I'm about halfway through. I want to pull them before I submit them.
All right, so. Okay. So everybody take a look. We'll look at the minutes of the last meeting and if there's any changes or omissions.
You were here at the last meeting, weren't you?
I wasn't. I had a question. The Quadro ballpark discussion and then the next one with the same asterisk group felt need to get it done. What's the it about the ballpark or what is that?
No, they felt that the group need to get it done now as needed, so not to scale it down to get it done as it was going to be needed, not to get it done right, basically. That's what they were trying to say.
Yes. Quadro was pretty adamant about building the thing out to a capacity, not a limited size building. Originally, we still stood by that.
Now, the price here that a Quadro was discussing, was that based on the same format measurements as initially started, or is the building a little bigger now?
The building is a little bit bigger.
And so these prices would reflect an increase then?
It wasn't known the cost of the drainage system in there.
This was just a ballpark of the building. It didn't include all the other stuff.
Right.
No construction infrastructure stuff, you're saying, just the building itself?
Right.
Okay.
Yeah, it's pretty much a finished building, I think, without the stuff in it.
Is there any additions, corrections, or comments on the minutes? If not, is there a motion to accept it?
Yes, you gotta get the attendees to make the motion. They were here, so we weren't, so we can't make a motion.
The only thing that needs to be added, Johnny, is Frank Aquadro was here. It's not in the attendees.
Yeah, you talked to him about here, but right. So you just gotta add Frank. Okay, with that addition, correction, is there a motion to accept them?
Make a motion to accept.
Is there a second? Is there a second to that?
Well, you can second it.
You can second it.
All in favor? Aye. All in favor, Myron?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. That's it. That was the only guys here that were at that meeting, so that's done. Okay. On the agenda, the Board of Appeals, the project, both projects have been submitted to the town clerk. And the date is August, is it August 25th, or what is that, Donald, that date on that?
I'm not sure. I don't have it written down anywhere, to be honest with you.
I think it was August 25th. I could be corrected on that, though. But I thought that that's the date they picked to hear both of these projects.
The projects as... this project or the larger fire department project, or which project are going to be submitted?
Both projects are going to go back to back. So the Green Bomb project will go and our project will follow. And we have to finalize, before that, we have to finalize the floor plan, what we're going to do there and the actual setbacks that we do. Is there any question on that?
On the hearing?
Yeah.
Just after last night's meeting, we have to get together with Mr. Greenbaum. We postponed it because there were some areas that was in discrepancies. So the board voted for Mr. Greenbaum to bring his proposal to the administrative assistant and iron out all of the problematic areas. and then the board will reconvene at our next meeting to vote on the sale.
To comment on that too, I want to bring that plan to Randy, and we'll let Randy on his CAD lay out exactly under what the code is, what kind of parking he really needs, and what he can actually use on that other site. You know, Mr. Greenbaum can say what he wants, but you know, we should know from Randy, he's a surveyor. He knows the zoning laws at, you know, what actually will work on that project. You know, that's right behind you, Mike, Myron.
I guess when we allotted him, you know, initially he wanted 40 feet, and this committee went to 50.
We set it at 40.
But it's 50 now.
Right, he wanted.
But after he has spoken to the zoning officer, our building inspector, he is telling him he needs 20 spaces. The part that we have allotted him allows him 10 spaces, he said. So he's looking for additional space in back or somewhere, you know, and your idea of taking his plot and going to Mr. Iser is a good idea, I think, because we'll see what we can get out of the lot for true parking without us having to give him additional space, because it'll disrupt the building.
But both lots now, because of what's there, are both going to be non-conforming, so they're both going to be dealt with the Board of Appeals. So the Board of Appeals does have the power to adjust that.
Right now, Mr. Greenbaum does have some parking to the right, where it's been always parking for fire personnel coming to respond. But his intention is to take that whole right corner and make it green space.
Yeah.
He doesn't want to use any of that for parking. So, you know, that's his idea now, and that's part of the discussion that he'll be having with the town administrator.
Excuse me, who was it that said that he had to have 20 parking spaces for the number of apartments he has?
Right. But again, that can be adjusted by the Board of Appeals, because as it is, both lots become non-conforming. So, you know, that can be argued out at the Zoning Board of Appeals.
When is this conversation with the town administrator going to happen?
Probably tomorrow again. They're already started.
Are we going to have anybody there?
I don't know. Are you going to be there?
I can be if you want me to.
Well,
when they meet, I'd gladly do it.
Yeah, why don't you? Yeah. Then you can bring all that
information
back.
And bring the information back.
Just so that there's no, that we're all going on the same.
Yeah, good idea.
The same level.
So, Donald, you're gonna attend that meeting then?
I'll check with Mr. Nixon to find out exactly what the date and time is, and I will attend.
So if by any chance you can't make it, call me and I'll go there. Okay.
See, there was one problematic area I brought up last night that, and this is his proposal for purchase of real estate. And initially, he offered $72,000 in the original bid for everything. Now that we've taken the land away, he is offering $40,000 and 50 feet north. If for some reason his project goes ahead and the safety complex does not, he's requesting the remainder of the land and offering $100,000. But I brought it up last night. I think the town, even if his project goes ahead, we should retain that land because of the access to the lake alone. We shouldn't forfeit it because there's no other areas that the town can get access to the lake if it ever gets cleaned up and use it for residents' recreation. So I don't know if we can include that in our specifications going to the ZBA, because the way it is set up now, we both go to ZBA, we pass. Then they go to the planning board, we pass. Then we go to town meeting, safety complex fails. he doesn't have to go to town meeting. His project is all done at that point because he doesn't have to look for funding. He has his own funding in hand, so. But we have to look for additional funding with an override.
But you don't know how the ZBA awarded it. That's the key thing.
That's the key thing.
The ZBA can word it
other
than what he wants. He can maybe want, but not necessarily that's going
to
happen.
That's what I was leading to. Does this committee want to have discussion today to see how we would enter into the ZBA hearing with our request, what should happen?
I think we have time, because that is August 25th. We have time to think about it. We'll talk about it, but everybody think about it. You know, that what you would like to see on that ruling and the way, because everybody will have a right to speak their piece at that hearing.
And the other factor with bears in mind with me, directly across the street, he has a parcel half acre to three quarters of an acre that is completely empty, where he could take some of that and make additional parking for his building also. You know, that's a factor that should be discussed. And it will be Mr. Nixon.
You brought that up last night at that hearing. You did bring that up.
Does he have an agreement already to buy?
No buy and sell yet.
No bought and sale. So he could say, forget this, you know, I'm pulling out.
Right.
If he wants to.
But it looks like he's very much interested in taking on this project.
And he wants to work with everyone. He wants to work with the town. He wants to work with the Congregational Church in North Hadley, too. It's sort of a project for everyone involved, a municipal project and a community project together. You know, some of the ideas that this committee has parking ideas to get the church off the dangerous highway there, crossing the road to attend services, providing that for them. You know, we probably won't have parking to accommodate your suppers, which sometimes probably get 75 cars or more.
But there ain't that room on that side of the road.
There's
either.
No room anywhere to deal with that.
Right.
So,
what was brought up that at that meeting we had with Stuart was about the blacktop, all the blacktop. We could take all the parking away from what would intend to do for overflow for the church and put that all into green. So I think, you know, we need to talk to their neighbors about that. He's going to maybe ask us to do a presentation to the church there and the folks there. And I'm certainly willing to take what we have and go in front of them. I think this all came out just as courtesy to the church and to make it a safer place for their parishioners and folks that meet there and do things together. On that same site, the question was the parking out back. And what I would suggest is we set that up on a permit basis for people that are going to have use for the North Hadley Pond, because it's town funds, that it's for town residents only and by a permit, just like they do in a reservoir. That would eliminate that from a great overflow from people from all over the state to come and take up all the parking there. You know, I mean, I don't know how that's even going to be used there, that with all that foliage and everything that's going on that pond there. So it's maybe it'll never be used, you know.
It used to be used before the foliage grew.
I mean, but it's getting worse now.
Yeah, I know.
You know, and it's just spreading and spreading until they dredge it or put weed killer in there or something, you know, but that's another whole story. That's out of our...
I just had a general question. Now, the last town meeting, the town voted to sell the North Hadley Hall. And that's a done deal. They haven't voted to do anything else. In other words, put any money into anything else at this point, correct?
That's why this is going in front of town meeting.
Yeah.
Right. It, you know, it's a new proposal, and the selectmen looked at this, that it's a viable proposal instead of the taxpayers buying some land when they own the land already. So that's our job, is to put together a plan, a building, and put it in front of the voters and taxpayers of this community.
The warrant article that was proposed by town meeting was twofold. One was to charge the selectmen to try to sell the building first. Secondly, if that was not attainable, then we would consider demolishing it. And it isn't anybody's intention to demolish it. If we can get it back on the tax rolls, providing the town of Hadley $15,000 to $18,000 in taxes a year, which is very beneficial to the town.
All right. Do you want to propose your floor plan or the layout of that building?
Right now?
Yeah.
Sure.
So Myron and I met, and then I met with the police chief and electrical inspector and a number of other police and firefighters, and this is strictly just a draft document. So we took the layout of this.
Is there any way you could put that right up there so we could all... I'll look at that.
So this is a first stab at it. Basically what we decided was initially this was just being looked at as
Can everybody see that okay?
We can pass it around too. It was initially being looked at as just a fire substation, but we're a public safety community here. So in discussions with the police department, we felt that because of the limitations of this building right now, and we have the north end of Hadley that needs to be covered as well, as we've incorporated some police assets into the building as well. And then redundancy for our communication center. So in the event that, for example, we have a tornado that goes through, we have a major flood, if this building for some reason goes down, we have the ability to move our operations up to the substation and work out of this and still have fire protection and communications for the community. So basically, the proposed building is an open structure. So basically it would be open steel. So you build your office space inside, and you have the ability to do a mezzanine area. And then your bay area where your fire trucks are parked is open to the ceiling. So basically what we did is we kept everything on this side so that we would have a large mezzanine area above it.
Explain what a mezzanine, in case someone don't know what a mezzanine is.
So basically a mezzanine is the structure below is rated to be able to support a floor structure above. Basically it's the ceiling, so this above this would be plywood floor, or whatever you decide to put up there, that could all be usable storage space. We could use it as training area. For example, Great Barrington Fire Department has a mezzanine storage space that they use for some of their training props. Granby Fire Department has a mezzanine storage area where they have a weight area for their firefighters to work out, to do also for storage and everything. So basically, it's just good use of the space above the offices and everything that you have below it. So this section here, back to front, so this is the river drive side, and this is the rear where the pond would be. We've put in a sally port for one cruiser, and that was all measured out to make sure that they have the clearance that they would need. We also increased the size of the door, because the doors are pretty tight right now, so in an effort to keep from damaging vehicles that are, they've gone to an expedition style vehicle or an explorer style cruiser now, because the Crown Victorias are no longer being made. So it's a little bit bigger of a structure.
Can you explain why the need of a satellite park?
Well, I mean, what we're looking at is basically you see the parking lot out here. There's a lot of vehicles here. So we're looking at, and this is just a preliminary idea that the Chief Mason and I were discussing. That we have parking spaces to the rear of the structure here. So his idea was, why don't we get some of these cruisers parked up north, and one of them that would be in operation. So right now you have a north officer and a south officer. So you have North District and South District. So the thought was, have the officer report to the north station, and we can get into what they have for resources to be able to change up here. They're no longer going to be punching in. They'll be calling in to state that they're going on into service, just like the state police do. They sign on the air. That's when their time frame starts. So this would give them the ability to park their car inside in the event there's a snowstorm, bad weather, if it is hot weather, they want to keep the car from having to run outside all the time. You know, they'll be able to keep that car either or warm or cool.
And then another point of this, this is not adding on no more police. This is on existing team now.
This is existing. Again, so we identified some needs that we have here right now. So as of right now, the police chief is out of locker space for the officers that he has. So what we've done is I don't have it labeled here, but we've created some locker room space where those officers can put their gear up in that space. So basically, in talking with the electrical inspector, I guess there's a utility pole here. He said this would be the north elevation. He said this side would be the best for bringing in water, sewer, and power. So basically what we did was we lined it and basically modeled it after what we have here in the station with dimensions, and then also just other additional information. So current code requires that if you have an emergency generator, you have to have all the switch gear for it in its own rated room. So that's this first space here. And then we will put a pad out here for the generator. Electrical room is just for all your regular electrical stuff. And then the mechanical room would be heating, bringing in the water supply. And then potentially, if required, the building may be required to be sprinklered. So your sprinkler riser would come into that space, fire alarm. That would be the hub for all those utilities. Then we just, so the entrance from the Sally Port, you come in, there'll be a rated door here because this is a garage style structure. It'll have some gun lockers here, and then access to office area where the police officers can write their reports and do their day-to-day work. We've also put in a kitchen. That would be for both police and fire. So we've created it so that firefighters can come in through the back space, police officers can come in through the back, they can access the kitchen, they can access restrooms, shower, and then what we decided to do, the problem that we have here is this is a secured building, but we have folks that come up to use this room for meetings. And they can, we have a sign on the door, but they can easily walk down into the back part of the structure, into the fire bays, and there's no policing of that if we're not here. So what we've done is we've separated the community, so they'll still have the ability to use the meeting room. Basically, they would enter the front door, they would have their own public restroom, and then they can enter the meeting space, and this door here would allow for, if an officer needed to come in and interview somebody up in North Hadley, they could access it, but this would be a secured door into the kitchen. But it would allow for them to have the meeting room, and then also if they wanted to use the kitchen for an event, we could. These doors would also be lockable, so they could use the kitchen.
How big is that meeting room?
The meeting room is approximately 15 by 17 inches. We have front mic.
So that's smaller than this one.
So it's a little bit smaller than this one, yes. Mm-hmm. There is some flexibility. Like I said, this is a draft. So this kitchen can be scaled back a little bit. We could probably take another 3 feet up this kitchen and still have ample room in there. Mm-hmm. So again, this is the first draft of it. Also, my walls are scaled out a little bit bigger than a regular wall, so there's going to be a little bit more room here. I hand drew this. I don't have a nice CAD yeah. system.
I wish Mr. Quadro was here, but he was very adamant in our first meeting that he wanted a total build out for the lot. I guess that's my first question. Are we doing that? And can you explain to the citizenry the size of the floor space presently at this complex versus the size of the floor space? Because some people think we're doing a Band-Aid, this is going to last 20 years. This is a build-out for 60 to 80 years, I believe, right?
Oh, easily.
Easily,
I
so.
I would say there's actually room for expansion, and I'll get into that. But you have a 100 by 65 foot structure. So do the math on that. We're 6,500 square feet. So just to put it into scale, our bay downstairs that houses all our apparatus right now is 3,018 square feet. So it's half the size of this structure.
Yeah.
So this is our main station, and we have that here. So that's, you know, that's a reasonable, but we're also incorporating some police assets in here. We're also incorporating, this is the heart of the structure right here, the dispatch center. So we would be putting a redundant dispatch center in here that would allow, again, if our dispatch center went downstairs. And now let me give you an example. Yesterday we had a power outage, so 500 customers, Rocky Hill Road, East Street, completely out, no power. I got called at 6 o'clock or 6:30 in the morning to say that our generator downstairs went offline, the motherboard fried and failed. So we do have triple redundancy. We have battery backup, but it's only rated to last about approximately a half hour. So it was an immediate 911 to Western or EverSource, see what they could do, and then Mitch, Sergeant Cook, and myself were already pre-planning on how we were going to get generators started and support our dispatch center downstairs until we could figure out what we were going to do. The generator's been fixed. Like I said, the board on it went. This system runs every Monday at 3 o'clock, so it's not like it's not tested. It's serviced annually. It happens. So that's why we're looking at the ability to be able to move to the north. We could have gone right up to the north station, put a dispatcher in that space, and all operations would have been going just as normal. So that's a small example. You know, I can give you the example of Springfield. Springfield had a tornado right down the street. You watched some of the storms that were coming up right across the river here. That's one of my biggest concerns, is that we're going to get, that this building is going to get knocked out for some reason, and we're not going to have anywhere to go. So this is set up to handle that completely. It would have our 911 capability and our radios in it. In the future, we've been discussing a potential ambulance service. This dispatch would also allow for an E911 emergency train dispatcher if we get to that point of having our own ambulance service in town. We could dispatch out of this for ambulance. So that's, you know, we're looking 50 to 80 years into the future here. We've also put in, like I said, we did unisex bathrooms, handicap accessible, and a single shower. We felt that that was ample enough for what we would have for staffing in here, even down the road, 25, 30 years. We figured probably the max it would be housed up in here, if we actually house people here, would be 2 or 3 firefighters. So then moving into the fire bay, so you have access to dispatch, you have access to police, and then fire. So what we did is we put in, right now, they're labeled as office or future bunk rooms. So these are spec'd out based upon the DRA report that the town had done in 2013, I believe. They came in and did reviews of all the buildings with potential expansions. So they looked at adding the bay on here, adding some storage space off of the police side, and then there's a little section in the middle between the dispatch center and the fire station where there's a a setback. They were talking about putting in some, a day room and then some bunk space, so that's, these rooms are specced right off of that, which is standard size for a single person, 7 by 9, 7 feet by 9. And then an office, in order for, you come back from a call, you have space here to go in and write the run report out. There's also extra space in here for an officer to be on standby. There's times when we need two dispatchers going, even today. There's times when a firefighter will be called in or a police officer will be called in when we have a bigger event, because the one dispatcher is handling strictly with the incident and the second one still has to answer the 911s for car accidents, medical calls, everything else. So we left enough space here in order for multiple people to be working in that area. We also have the room for the E911. So the bay itself, Myron and I discussed it for quite a while. We felt that two bays would look much nicer than having three bays. We just didn't think it was necessary. So we did feel it was necessary to get a little bit wider of a door. It's extremely.
Are you talking about, Chief, two doors instead of three doors? Is that what you're referring
to? Two doors instead of three doors, roll-up doors. So you'll have the main entry here. So I'll give you a little story about that after another suggestion of the police chief. But right now, we'll deal with the fireside. So this block here is actually the scale of our biggest piece. It's our ladder truck. So this is scaled of what the ladder truck would look parked into this space if we ever needed to park it there. So you can see there's ample room here.
What's that little square above?
This here?
Yes.
Basically what we, the only part that I haven't done yet, we started discussing access to the mezzanine. So we need a way to get up to this mezzanine for the storage. And we thought it might be a good idea to put a landing here and then stairs coming down. So stairs to a platform and then down. So it would spread it out this way. And then we could put our firefighters' turnout gear lockers underneath that, so we would maximize that space and not take up more space.
So the stairway would be in the middle of those two bays coming down?
No, it would be just on this left side right here. I don't know, like I said, I have to scale this out a little bit more. I have a little bit more work to do on that. But we figured if we have firefighters staying here or even firefighters coming in, the first thing they come into is their turnout gear, which is the first thing they need to put on before they get on the truck. So we figured that would be a good use of that space.
There's only one doorway in the back to access that.
There's one doorway in the back to access this space. And then we have one roll-up door in the back that we decided to put on because this bay, a second bay here, which is 14 feet wide, would allow for multiple vehicles to be parked, but we could also park one facing out the back to go out. So brush truck, our mini pumper, whatever we decided to park in that space, it would allow us. We didn't want to do a drive-through because it ends up, you have to move everything out of the way before you can bring the truck through. It didn't make any sense. So we figured being able to respond out this way and respond this way, and that keeps that area clear in the back.
By putting in a smaller third door, it wouldn't look aesthetically, you're saying? Is that the reason why? I'm saying a third door, a little bit smaller, not 14 foot, to accommodate like a rescue boat where they could back right up, hook it, and pull it out.
In the front?
In the front, where you'd still have a door there, the third door.
You would lose all your office stuff and everything.
No, to the right. The two overhead doors are taking up all of the bay space?
Yep.
Yeah. Well,
oh, okay. I thought there was a remainder left.
No. Basically, what we really needed to do was leave. We are extremely tight downstairs because of the size of the doors. For space to, we have turnout gear, and then we have to walk between the truck and the turnout gear.
That's here.
Yeah, that's here.
But I'm referring to the doors in the new complex.
The new complex, the doors are wider. We put 14 rather than 12-foot doors.
And okay. The reason is that it makes it more safe to back in without clipping the fire truck or doing anything.
Not just that. There's also requirements now for fire stations. You have to have an exhaust system under NFPA standard. Those systems require additional space because they hook down from the ceiling and hook onto the truck's exhaust, and then they slide on a rail as the truck goes up and flop back. So we need that additional space on the sides of the truck. It also allows for a clear space here because we've had issues in the past where the person driving the truck doesn't have clear view because it's so tight over here with all the stuff that you can't, it's hard, sometimes it's hard to see a firefighter walking because they have to walk right up against the truck to get into it.
Was so, this building built before those regulations came into play?
This building was built before, I mean, there are stations that have had it, you know, at the time that was built, but I mean, we've been looking for grant funding for a number of years to put that in, but it's hard to come by.
I think it was around $38,000 or something for a system to take care of the exhaust.
So what we
to
have,
put it in here cost $38,000.
So what they did is they put in, basically we flip on a switch and there's vents that suck the exhaust out. So the concern with that is when the vehicles are started, the exhaust gets all over the turnout gear that's next to it, which then you're now exposing to your firefighters. So your firefighters are getting into turnout gear with the exhaust that's
when you have two Class A pumpers parked there, the back door will allow you approximately how much space for other equipment?
Our ladder truck would not be parked up here, but I wanted to put the biggest truck we had. So we would be looking at, rather than 40 feet, 30, 32 feet for a pumper. So basically, I looked up the length of an F-350 full extended cab. And that was 21 feet, so that would allow for our pumper and basically that style truck, our mini pumper, an ambulance, and that mini pumper. So I mean, there's a substantial amount of space there. We could even park, you know, depending on how this lays out. You know, this doesn't have to happen. This was just something we drew in. We could reconfigure this and actually park a smaller piece here too.
Not to get away.
But how would that smaller piece get out? It would have to move the front piece out?
And then that truck would go out, yeah.
Not to get away from what you're explaining, but I was down the highway garage today. Did we just recently acquire a tanker?
Yes.
It's being worked on in there now?
Correct. That tanker, actually we received it, I'd say a couple of years ago, but we've been raising funds to get it done. And now we have the funding that was approved at town meeting. That's a 2010 military surplus that we got for free. It's a $100,000+ piece of equipment that we got for nothing. So we are now, the $16,000 that was approved at town meeting is to build that truck out to replace a 1972 that we have that's time to go.
Explain the need of that tanker so that people can understand. Why do you need a tanker?
The tanker, we originally used to run, it's called a deuce and a half. It's a 2.5-ton vehicle, but it was way undersized for the tank. We have a 1,250-gallon tank on the back of it, so the weight of that was too much for that deuce and a half. So we moved to it's called a 5-ton military surplus. So basically, we use it for multiple things. It goes out on brush fires. It goes up to the mountain. It can go to areas of town where we don't have water supply right now, so we can start firefighting. Myron has been helping us design this tanker because we're changing things out on it. We're going to be putting our water bag on it that's now currently on engine 2 on there, so we actually have the ability to set up a tanker shuttle operation, dump water in it for some of these places. For example, Hockenham, Aquavita, Honeypot, where we don't have a lot of water. We have water that we can get, i.e. the Connecticut River, but you need a place to bring it out and put it into so you can keep that bag filled. And then we have a good sized pump on that tanker. We'll have a lot of hose line on it, so we could actually start an operation with that. So that's the purpose. Myron, you got anything to add on the tanker truck?
No, I think we have quite a few houses on after the road. Like I said, we don't have any water supply. We have areas of town just still on the old 100-year-old water mains that follow South Maple Street. The tanker out there, there's really no water available in either. Moody Bridge Road area. Same thing with all the
Mountain Road and all that, right?
Mountain House. We have a potential for bigger brush fires as we had a few years ago on the mountain. It's a very handy piece of equipment because it allows the firefighters to have their extra water right away instead of waiting for mutual aid to come in later. Basically, all we have is initial attack capability. We still have to rely on out-of-town tankers. If we really have a real serious fire, we would use a tanker shuttle. But we have that tanker in operation now for, I don't know, probably 20 years. Mm-hmm. We have had fires where it was,
especially like a season that's so dry now, it just, the level is so high.
Yeah, I mean, that tanker's been up in the some of the backfields. We had a hay bale fire. That tanker responded because it can get out that. It's an all-wheel drive vehicle. We've had a number of cars that have been stolen. People drive them up into the woods, and, you know, they're driving all over, and they've started on fire. So that gives us the water we need. There's a big difference between our little brush truck that has 125 gallons on it versus 1,200. You get a lot more bang for your buck bringing that truck with you. So I think it's a critical piece, and we're designing it, I think, really, really useful this way, so that it's going to dump water out quickly. I think it's going to be, for what we paid for it, nothing. I think it's going to be a huge asset to us.
Presently, do we keep that truck? Do we have space to keep it now?
Yes, it'll be replacing the truck that we have downstairs.
That would be undercover.
Correct.
Okay.
No, that's just what I was going to ask. You got it for nothing. Town voted money to fix it up, and now we've got it. And do we have a place to park it?
We do.
Okay.
Yes.
What was the justification for having a police auxiliary part to this building? That's new to me. I didn't realize that was.
Well, I mean, obviously, the amount of space that they're looking for is pretty minimal in the big scheme, but it allows for an officer to be up in that area of town for a quicker response rather than being down here. So if they're not out patrolling, if they're here doing their reports and a call comes in, there's a significant time difference for them coming from here or being up in that north station if they're working. One of the other ideas that Chief Mason and I were discussing is I think it would be a nice addition to the North Hadley community, you know, that I don't know if you've seen some of the old police and fire stations, but when the station is in operation, you either have a blue light or a green or a red light out on the front of the building telling you that you're welcome to come in if you need help. So the Chief Mason and I were discussing having those blue and red lights there. So if there's a police officer in that station doing his reports or working up in that area of the town and something happens, we have people would be surprised how many times we have cars pulling into the front of the station here because somebody's having a medical emergency. A month ago, we had someone who was having an allergic reaction. We've had folks pull in with chest pain, and the hospital has told them to stop. So that would be a good opportunity for folks in North Hadley to feel like there's a presence of police up in that neck of the woods and that they're going to get there that much quicker. And it's again, we're talking about you know, a 25 plus year plan. So this is allowing for, if this building, you know, it's gonna take time for us to make the decisions on this structure, if it's gonna be built out more, if there's been talk about, you know, utilizing this for something different and putting the public safety building somewhere else. You know, there's a lot of different options on the table, and this seemed like a really good idea to provide some additional protection for the townspeople in North Hadley. And again, we're public safety, so it's also providing redundancy. So if the police station went down, those police officers could go up in here and be working out of this station. So
now, something else to bear in mind, too. 90% of the new growth is in the northern tier of town. And I'm talking homes that are $600,000 to $700,000. There's 35 more on the docket right now to be built up in the northern tier. And we don't have any subdivision plans in the southern tier to be built. So it's another reason why this is very important to have this facility.
So that's about the scope of it. There is a 20-foot setback on this side. We added a door over here so that if we wanted to have a smaller patio area where we could, you know, folks could sit outside or barbecue out there or whatever, you know, we just added that in there. Just trying to throw in a bunch of ideas of how we could do it. This is by no means set in stone, it's just some ideas. We were talking about maybe if there could be a little bump out here to kind of break up the front face of it so the entryway would be covered. And then, you know, we do suggest some type of a hose tower where our hose can be dried in, and we're thinking this might be a good location over here, but that's all stuff that we can put in, you know, afterwards.
Is that inside the building or outside the building?
It's inside the building. I mean, we could do a small bump out here, or if it had to be built in inside. I mean, it's not a necessity because they have hose drying racks that you can roll around now. There's all different options, so that's all stuff we can.
And you're not really addressing on top of the mezzanine, the second floor. That's
no.
That could be put into anything.
That's right. This would all be expandable space. So again, we do have building code that, you know, there is accessibility needs, but ultimately it's expandable enough where we could go up and add additional living space, additional storage. We're talking about some training props up in there. That way we're pulling it out of this station that's maxed out in full.
Mm-hmm.
So that's some of the
ideas. Is there any room in the plan for like a small conference community room?
That was this meeting room here.
Yeah, I was wondering if that's in the plan and Mr. Greenbaum knows that, then he has no reason to put a community room in his building. I understand.
After last night, his plan for a community room is out. His whole building is going to consist of 10 single studio units only.
If he put a community room, he would have put 9.
No. They would have been different configurations, much smaller, apparently, but and now it's just set on 10, and that's it. No community room or anything, just 10 studio apartments he's requesting.
It's an apartment building. Okay. You know, initially he had said that he was going to be responsive to the community and have a room for community meetings and...
That was part of the original contract,
yes.
And there was also space on the bottom for retail. And he's decided no retail because his expertise is not in developing retail. His expertise is remodeling historical buildings. And that's where he wants to spend all of his time on that building, remodeling it to be...
I think his expertise is as a landlord myself, but then that's... That's my own opinion.
Chief, that mezzanine, is that wall going to go straight right up to the roof to be sealed off?
It's not required to be. We could tour some of the structures that are open. Granby's is open above the space. They're building, I believe, a space.
The whole mezzanine up top, what has it got, a 4-foot railing on it so people can't fall off it?
Yeah.
Does Belcher Town have a mezzanine?
That's one station I've been meaning to go out and visit. I couldn't tell you if they do.
I think they do because when I lived in Belchertown, they had pancake breakfasts. They moved all the fire equipment out and had it right in the bay. And I can almost positively say they have one on the left side. Sort of the same configuration you have.
That's the other good thing about this for the North Hadley community is we do it here quite frequently. We have public safety, you know, programs where we bring the public in to view stuff. All this stuff gets moved out and there's a lot of space here. So if somebody wanted to have an event in here, for them to come to the fire department and say, can we use this space? If we can wrap in some sort of a fire safety program where we're educating seniors or kids or whatever, we're more than happy to pull our trucks out and make this space available. We've done a number of those events here with bringing, you know, the public together. We used to have the Chili Glunky cook-off here. We did for 4 or 5 years where we brought the fireworks back and had them out here. We had, you know, the sheriff's department IDing children. We had doing the iris scan for them. We had UMass nursing students doing blood pressures for folks. And I mean, it's this is your community building. This is where it's supposed to happen. The fire station is, you know, it's the center of your, it's the center of your community. I would like to say one other thing because it came up actually in my son's soccer game, and I think it needs to be addressed and clarified that by no means are we looking to do this strictly so that we get more full-time staff in here. I've made it very clear on a number of occasions that we are always going to have a call force department be supported by a call force department. So regardless of what happens, if we bring in full-time staffing, even if we decide to utilize this space for an ambulance or for a truck going out the door, we're still always going to need those folks that show up as call force members to get on those trucks, because there's no way that the town, and never would I ask that or expect that we could staff 24/7 with, like, Northampton. Northampton has 13 firefighters in their station 24/7, sometimes 17. So they figured it out with their ambulance service how they can support that. I think that we can have an engine company 24/7 that's supported by the call force. But that way, at least we're having a fire truck show up at your house with the proper number of people that can safely enter the building and start working on the fire. That's the priority. It's the safety of the citizens. It's not trying to have folks sitting around just spending their day.
How big a vehicle do you have planned for the inside?
What's spec'd now? So you've seen the station, the North Hadley Hall right now, the North Hadley station. Basically, the way it works here is when we bring in a new pumper, the next newest goes north. So our engine 3, which I think is 34 or 36 feet, is slated to go north. So that truck would be parked here.
So 36 feet?
34 or 36. So
what's the frontage?
45 feet.
We have 45 feet for that. And we're going to be talking about, I guess, the...
To the road's edge.
Street lights, the, you know, the lights that you set off when to...
No, I just want to make sure that the vehicle come out and close the doors and you still have...
Yes.
Okay, so we're not at 30 feet, we're at 45.
Right. Yep. Okay.
When you say lights, do you mean there would be stop lights put in on River Drive?
Either that or a warning light. They have the light up, you know, fire truck entering ahead, you know, something along those lines that would notify people to slow down that there's a truck coming up.
Well, there would be a lock and light, a red light, one on the south end, one on the north end, and one on Middle Street that would be activated from the truck. When they're either coming out of there, responding to a fire, or coming back in, they lock those lights, they drive either north or south on the road and back right back in the station. So it makes the village safe, and it makes the safety for the firemen.
So do you mind if I'd like to present Chief Mason?
Go ahead.
He was out very late last night, had to get home with his kids tonight. Kind of like I have to at some point. The police chief, he was unable to be here tonight, but he wants to make the same offer that I put out for any questions. He's asked to please feel free to reach out to him via email, or you can call the business line to ask any questions as to how it relates to not only our concept, but anything related to public safety. If you have any questions about why things happen the way they happen and why we are doing the operation the way that we are. And he gave me a bigger thing here if you want to zoom in on it with his email on it. So folks can get in touch with him by email.
Well, I think you can give that to Richard and he can list that right on TV5.
Okay. Yep, you can have that.
And is yours on there if they want to contact you?
I can write mine on there so you can have that as well.
Right, so you can list that, Richard? Good.
I'll use my phone. Let's see.
And that's if anybody out there, any resident of Hadley has any question whatsoever, what we're doing, why we're doing it, and what direction the police and fire are going. So there's a lot of questions like, why can't Sunderland handle the north end? Why can't Amherst handle the north end? And, you know, we're going to explain all that. We're going to try to set up a documentary you know, with the two chiefs and a moderator, once we get all these questions in, that we can publicly answer any kind of question that hopefully we can answer that comes forward.
Prior to starting to talk about layout and parking lot, can we talk a little bit about the roof design in the building? I'm not sure you have that information, the chief, but you may. What the type of building would look like,
well,
and things of that nature. I know it's not setting
what
concrete.
What they just did here is a standing seam roof, right, Michael? Chief?
On this?
On this building.
They're putting on a standing
right.
seam. Yeah, that's what's
and,
proposed.
I talked to Nyhart about it, and he certainly would recommend a standing seam building on that. You know, I certainly like to see a cupola on the top, you know, I mean, so the thing fits into this colonial village. But, you know, we still can hear from the people what they want to see, what they would like to see, and see if we can incorporate that in this project.
Would it have vinyl siding like here, or would it be proposed like brick veneer?
But the whole front would probably be brick veneer, you know, and the back certainly could be metal. The sides you're not going to really see; it's going to be set back there, so that could be metal, you know.
Again, I think we're looking at a long life structure. So whatever the best product is for that long
right.
life is what Frank and everybody was discussing last time to make sure
right.
that this is a building that's going to stand the test of time.
We got to iron this out first and then spread out to the outside of that building, you know.
I think there was a conversation to possibly a pre-engineered building,
yeah.
which would save us a lot of money, and we wouldn't have to pay for all the design cost and
mm-hmm.
engineering and all that. That was something Mr. Quadro
yep.
suggested, and he's in that building trade.
That was talked about from day one with a pre-engineered.
Was this building not built for a long-term safety complex?
I would say that this building was probably built for maybe a 15 to 20 year. I don't think it looked into the future of what was being built out for the community. So, you know, there's folks here who were part of that building committee, and I think the original design was to have an additional bay on there with the understanding that we're probably going to fill this up pretty quickly. And
the money wasn't voted or something?
I wasn't
was a member of the board of selectmen.
We wanted to do that. A few of us members wanted to do it on the committee, but the rest of the committee didn't want to take it back to town meeting. We had the original vote, so it's just like, to me, they had nothing to lose. It was the extra stall into brick veneer this entire building.
The first vote was much larger. It failed. So the committee regrouped, brought another design back, which was much smaller
mm-hmm.
and saving of a great deal of money, but it wasn't the initial building that they really wanted that would have served
or
this
needed.
Town maybe another 20 more years.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's what we're confronted with today, a lot of changes. And that's town meeting sometimes. You're going to get what they vote you, and you're going to live with it.
But
so.
I really think the explanation, people have a right to ask any question, and it's our job to answer those. And it's to build this building. Where there was mistakes done to this building, let's not make these mistakes from here on going forward. Let's try to be smart about it. Let's not try to answer the town's needs and all the voters and the taxpayers, you know, and just do the best we can, you know, to get the end result. And I think we're headed in the right direction. I'm proud to even serve on this committee because it does take a lot of time, but it is a good town. You know, we got a good fire chief, a good police chief. They work hard to enhance their departments, and I think the people really need to pay attention because they serve the people.
You know, we have a lot of debt coming off because the school and safety complex payments are completed. So that frees up an avenue for us to borrow more money without even affecting the tax rate.
Right.
And the second thing I would like to mention, we just went out and borrowed $347,000, and we got it for less than 0.75%, which, so it's indicative now, it's the right time for towns to borrow. It looks like the economy is still going to continue on, and we could get the most bang for our dollar right now by borrowing and going forth with a project of this nature.
Well, what Donald said is true, because with the debt that's going to be excluded, this will take up that spot and not cost the town any new taxes. Is that right?
Depending on the final cost.
I'm not talking about the budget. I'm talking about a capital outlay.
If you're looking at this capital project, taking out what's going to be paid out or paid off, and a new capital project taking its place,
right?
You're right.
Right.
But there are other capital needs that may or may not.
And the operating, that's altogether
different.
Right.
And this is the only piece of land that the town owns in North Hadley that would be feasible. Is that it?
They don't own anything else.
Yeah, the only piece that we own. Mm-hmm. So you have, you know, they have out the request for proposals right now, looking for other pieces of property. Mm-hmm. But that's something that we would have to purchase.
And they'll be submitted by July 26th, so we'll know if there's any other proposals out there that would request us to look at them.
Yeah. Keep in mind that there might be some generous soul in Hadley. Hadley never purchased that piece of land. It was given to North Hadley not for the school, for land next to the school for recreation. Mm-hmm. So it was a gift. It wasn't a gift to make a fire department. It was a gift for recreation. And I think we have to keep those kinds of things in mind.
Well, if you can find
it's taken for
what?
Eminent domain.
No.
No.
The original was the Scott family donated it to the town.
But it said
actually for a school, I believe.
It said on there that it was taken
for eminent domain.
Right.
Yeah.
On the deed.
Well, some deeds can be.
We took it by eminent domain, I believe. But it was originally donated, and the deed originally said if it is no longer used for recreation, it would revert back to the Scott family. Mm-hmm. So the town took it by eminent domain
to wipe that out
and put it on as a municipal building in the community of Hadley.
Okay. Our next part on this is the parking lot and the layout of the grounds on the outside of this building. Why don't you take that? That down there, and we can look at. Now, Randy Iser is the land surveyor that laid out the plot plan of the layout of the land here. And to the north boundary, next to the second church, we put in, how many spaces are there in that?
On the northern
side?
I think 18. Maybe I'm off one or two.
17 spots. In the back is yeah, I think it is the right corner. And then there was 10 or 11 in the back, isn't it?
And those are solely reserved for fire and police personnel.
But the door is going to be taking some, the sally port is going to take some, but there's still adequate room there for the volunteer firemen. And that doesn't stop them from parking on a side either. Right?
Right.
But in the front now, because of the arrangement with the two big doors, there could be green put in front, there could be things done that to pretty that part up, you know. And is there a tower or anything going, antenna, what's happening with that for communication?
That's something we have to look into further. I don't know if it's something that we can use the Montgomery Rose site, they, Verizon installed a receiver for us up there, so I don't know if we can utilize that and put some type of simple repeater inside the station rather than putting a tower up. So it's something we'd have to look at, but it could probably just go on the building if it had to.
You know, we're going to sit down and talk with the church about the parking there, and again, on this MS4, no water is going to be shed off this site. So it has to, under that MS4 mandate, it has to be all drainage. It has to be drained within that property boundary. There's none going to go out to the church property, to the south, or to the pond, or to the street. It's going to be all put underground, and that's what it's going
to
happen.
Mr. Chairman, I think probably right now it would be a good idea to let people know what this MS4 costs that site. That was drawn up by our highway superintendent.
No, it wasn't.
Was it?
This, we got a proposal from Time Bond, and the price of doing that MS4 drainage that's going to be mandated by DEP and the EPA is a cost of $125,000. Regardless where that building would go, on what property, you still got to comply with this drainage. And it's not just Hadley, it's all over. So that's a big expense.
What's the other piece of property going to utilize?
What other piece of property?
The adjacent piece of property.
He's going to have to comply with that too. That's not really our problem. We're not going to take his drainage and solve his drainage problem. He has to come up with a plan with that.
So we're proposing there's two totally independent.
Exactly, two different total projects. We're not taking his drainage, and we're not giving him our drainage. The parking in the back, and you know, I gave this some thought. This is going to be for access to the pond, and I certainly want to see that reserved to the Hadley resident with the same kind of deal they do with the reservoir. They buy a pass from the town, and it's not open to the general public all over. It's just only for Hadley residents. And access in, access out, access would be in through the left side around the building. The parking in the back will be strictly reserved for fire department personnel, and it would be a tow zone if someone else parks there, and exit out the other side. And we're going to propose locking lights, red light to stop traffic, one on the north side of the property, and one on the south side, and one off Middle Street. So that will be activated out of the trucks, the engines.
Now, an interesting thing we did today, we walked the site with the steward of the church, Stuart Beckley. He's also the town manager for Ware, and he's been a planner for a number of years. And he suggested something I wasn't aware of, and I'm going to be checking on it. He says Ware doesn't have to react to this drainage because they have a population under 10,000.
Right.
And why are we reacting this way with only 5,000 population? Mm-hmm. So it's something I was brought to my attention, I wasn't aware of, and I'm going to be discussing that with the administrator to find out.
But the engineer that did this, is that the towns have to comply with that. They're dealing with this.
But again, the other night at the hearing for the medical marijuana dispensary, they said their drainage was grandfathered in.
Because they're under the site. This is new construction.
What about the existing building, North Hadley Hall? Would that be grandfathered in for drainage?
I don't know. I'm not going to worry about what happens on the North Hadley Hall. We have enough to concentrate what's happening on our project, and that's what we should focus on. He's responsible, he's responsible for that, not us.
I realize that, but if we're putting in this complex drainage system, we may be able to receive compensation from him to tie into us to reduce our cost. So I think it's an area that should be discussed.
Then, mister, because you take all the square footage of that, this prep would go from 125 maybe to 200,000.
But it's worth checking out. Yeah, it's worth checking to see whether we have an exclusion or...
Well, absolutely.
To ask the same gentleman from Ty and Bond how it would be affected.
Yeah, I can talk to him.
I think the other thing that Weir doesn't have to worry about in the middle of town is they don't back up to a pond like this does. And so not only the, the town has to do it, but you have to comply with new rules about waterways, you know, because that back parking will come right up to the top of the hill, I would expect.
Right.
And then it's drainage straight down into the pond, which you can't do.
I have talked to Janet Stone from the Conservation Commission and asked her, do we have to hire an engineer to engineer this and to do, this is the estimate from an engineer, but I suggested to her that we wait to see if town meeting votes for it and the ballot question for it passes, then we go in front of the Conservation Commission with a letter of intent. That's where you hire your engineer to come up with a plan, and that's when it's done. Mm-hmm. That way, when the town's not spending a lot of money up front, not knowing what's going to happen in the end,
mm-hmm.
and which she agreed and,
right.
and made sense. Is there any questions or anything else on the site? I mean, greenway, green, we can add green to the front. You know, if the church is against the parking there, we can put all green there. There's, you know, well, you know, we want to work with the neighbors and see if we can make things work.
You know, in reference to what Mr. Michkowski said, he's already did the work speaking to the neighbors, and tentatively all the boundary lines are in agreement with our neighbors. It doesn't seem like there's any disputes over the boundary lines. So that is something that wouldn't tie us up in court for a period of time either, which is positive.
Randy didn't seem to worry about none of that, you know. But again,
well,
it could happen.
As we've talked about, I think the best thing, the conservative way to do it, is just enter into a boundary line agreement with each of the abutters,
right.
So that nobody brings up something, you know, as we're go further and further and more costs are involved. We don't want to go back and have
right.
a boundary dispute.
That's a good
it could alleviate a problem.
Just
come
do
down
it
later.
And be done with it. It's relatively cheap and easy.
All right, we talked about water, sewer, and what is all coming on the north end of the building, correct? All the utilities are coming to the north end.
Correct.
Sewer's right out on right the manhole. It's a deep sewer line, but the manhole's right on the intersection of Metal Street and River Drive, so that's easy enough. The concerns about there's a hydrant to be relocated. Did you take a look at that yet? That where's that going to go? Is that going to go to the north on the boundary?
We thought it would probably be best on the north. That way it can access. It would give us quick access for Meadow Street as well. And then they're also, they relocated the hydrant down to the south. Got moved on to that center common
mm-hmm.
area where people park when they're fishing. So that was moved from in front of the houses into that center common. So there is a hydrant there. But I think that would probably be the best location.
So that would be not a hard fix then to comply with that.
Do you agree with that, Myron?
You know, and I want to bring up about what do we do with all the snow? You can't dump it in the pond. So because of that, those back parking area there for the pond, I feel all that snow in that whole site could be piled right to that back section. Tapered back, put a manhole there so it goes right, everything goes into that and underground. There'll be a tank that'll pick up all the debris and stuff that's separated from the water. It's, you know, what's the feeling of everybody on that? You can't, I don't know, I don't see where else you could push it. You know, it's a logical spot to store that.
Yeah, you gotta keep it on site.
Right.
When they end up with a lot of snow now, they end up falling away from the neighbor. Existing station.
Where, here?
Yeah.
No, up north.
Yeah, but there's no place there, that's, it,
no, that's what he's saying, it's hauled, they haul it away.
It's hauled away.
Huh?
It's hauled away.
Yeah.
Which we may be confronted with if you have, you know, 110 inches or something, you know, it's a lot of snow.
Okay, I wanna bring up about the outreach and develop, public outreach through, the cable station and through other. We're setting up these phone lines to start calls of interest, calls of either complaints or calls of information that people can bring forward to us, questions they can bring forward to us, and we address them. You know, we could put out handouts, you know, hand them out, you know, with numbers on where to call, who to contact, you know, and my feeling would be to set up a documentary that would be set with a moderator and the two chiefs to explain in detail history of the department, the needs of coverage in the North Hadley section, what is it serve, who's it serve, and how is everybody in the whole town gonna benefit by this. So,
you know, it'd probably be in our best interest. I don't know if anybody has the talent here to create a website.
Yeah.
Because everything is done by computer. The days of handing paper to people are white elephant, and it's a waste of time and a lot more money.
I have that on here.
Oh, you do? I didn't go down there, yeah. But I don't know, you've gotta have somebody talented to create the website, you know.
But you can also use the existing town website.
It's true for information, which may be a good place.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Does anybody have any ideas or input into that?
No, I think it would be a good idea to use the town, and besides which, it could be updated as well. There are lots of other things on the town website which should be updated.
But what about the people that don't have computers or don't use that? How do we outreach them?
I think the local community access TV is an excellent way to do that.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, if there's some sort of a way to set a telephone line that, you know, they can call people on the committee. And,
you can always suggest that people go to the senior center or the library.
Mm-hmm.
And the people there will help people that don't know how to use the computers, mm-hmm. how to get the website.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And they're already paid for.
Well, we still could have handouts that say there, someone could put them out at the town dump. We could set them at Cumberland's, the library, the town hall, the banks, the donut shops, the senior center. You know, this is something we got to do a little bit creative work with, and to try to touch and reach out to everybody in town.
We could also create press releases to the local periodicals, Daily Hampshire, Springfield. That can be done through a computer press release, and they would pick it up, and hopefully they'd run a story on it.
Is there any way, Richard, that you could set up, like if this documentary is put together and moderated, that you could set it up on Channel 5 that it would be shown at a certain time and the day of the week or days of the week that it would be put on the TV? Or did they have to sit there and watch the whole thing? Can it be advertised that this documentary would be showed, say, at 7 o'clock Monday through Saturday or Monday through Friday?
What do you mean?
You know, like an explanation of, say, we're going to take all these questions.
Yeah.
And we're going to have a moderator ask the chiefs about it, and they're going to answer it.
Yeah.
And they'll do it with the police, they'll do it with the fire.
Yeah.
can we set like a certain time?
That it's going to air?
Right.
Yeah.
And that could be advertised for that.
And he could actually air it more than once, too.
Well, exactly.
It's up to him. Now, how does it work, like, on demand through a computer? You can put some things on demand, right?
Yeah, any meeting can be put up for on-demand viewing.
And so that means anybody could go to demand and watch it anytime they want on their computer.
Town's, our website, webpage.
On a town web?
Yep.
On HPAT's website, which is part of the town's webpage.
Mm-hmm. Does anybody else have any other idea or forum or what we could possibly do to try to invite people and get people involved? And, you know, I don't know if there's maybe a drop box for ideas or comments or what, place in different places. Does anybody have any idea of what else we could do to this?
We have our open house in the fall. We have, like I said, we open up the station. We could certainly set something up at those and advertise those. Mm-hmm. We could do something like that.
When is that usually?
It's usually in October.
Before town meeting?
We could certainly try. We could do
because
that.
I think that's yep. where all the questions
right.
are going to come.
We run it usually during Fire Prevention Week, which is normally in October, but you can do it
weeks
before.
Well, that's when the
before.
Town meeting is October.
Right.
October what?
27th.
Yeah, right. So it's the first week, so
yeah.
we would have a month or 3 weeks
prior
before.
To the
so
October.
That would be good timing.
October meeting, the board is doing what you call a forum,
yeah.
a financial forum. Where do your tax dollars go, and the reasoning why, and we're going to have a forum to explain the warrant articles. And if Edby wants to attend, that's one feedback we got last from our town meeting. Was a lot of the information wasn't answered at town meeting, and they couldn't render a vote, you know, properly to decipher how to really render it. So we're going to try to make it much more informed so people will know about every article and what they mean, and having the departments there, even if they're by petition, to explain them in its entirety before town meeting occurs.
When do we meet with the select board?
We could meet with them. When are they going to do that other thing with Greenbaum? When is that going to happen?
August. It might be the 12th. I'm not sure. I can't. There were so many dates tossed around last night. I can't remember.
Well, that's where we should get on the agenda with them. So if you could take care of that and then let everybody know. So we can make a presentation there to the board, right?
Because they should be kept abreast as
well
we progress.
I said last time I was in there yesterday that I would try to keep them abreast with everything that's going on here. So any information we have, you know, that's they certainly like to see the copies of the minutes over there, so they
you know,
have that.
This presentation that went on today, we. Arrived here at 7 and it's almost 8:30.
Mm-hmm.
You're not going to get that time element at a select board meeting.
No, but we talked
you know.
A lot about.
Well, but you could give a summary to them.
Right.
15 minutes maybe 15 or something
minutes.
Would be excellent, and somebody
right.
could present it, a combination, maybe the chairman, the police, and fire chief, taking 5 minutes each.
Right.
I don't know if the time when Greenbaum is going to be there would be the best selectman meeting to be at, though, because his price depends on how much land or how little land is going to go with the building. And his price is changed, you know, from every time he's met with the selectmen.
It's going to be all ironed out before our next meeting.
Right. Yeah.
And what we're going to be presenting will be the agreement between the town and him for a purchase and sell agreement. It should be cut and dry. All of those things are going to be ironed out.
And the lines of what that purchase and sale will be for will be ironed
exactly.
out at that time.
Yes.
Well, the selectmen made it clear that they don't want to sell the all the rest of the land with it. They you made that pretty clear to him at that meeting yesterday.
But as part of that purchase and sales agreement, it would behoove the town, the select board, to dovetail whatever we need with this project with
that purchase and sales. So if somewhere down the line we have to do drilling and borings and whatnot, that he's aware of that and he agrees to that. And it's, you want to make sure that it works. So you're not just getting a purchase and sales agreement in the dark, and only to turn around and have him fighting us while we go forward with this project.
I think our board's intention to just get the agreement, and then there's going to be the town attorney and his attorney get together with all the ideas to create the document that'll govern everything.
Just as long as they're aware that there's going to be an active construction site adjacent to this, so that we're not, you know, it's some of these things, you get tunnel vision and you say, okay, we're just selling this piece of property, this is the way it's going to be, boom, 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 and not take into consideration what's going to happen next door.
And last night, the building committee also said that this committee could use the new OPM that they're hiring to govern this project. So a lot of those questions could be answered by him as we ask them.
My only concern is that this committee works hand in hand with the select board and the attorneys to make sure that everything is going smoothly.
Do you want to be involved in that part of the talks? See, you are an attorney.
Retired.
You're never going to be retired. Hey.
Sure, I'll do that.
Good. So that's good.
And this is one option out of multiples, correct? Because the selectmen are looking at, they're bringing in that information that's coming in on July 26th for proposals. So this is just one more thing to look at, so right. That there's multiple options for the town.
Right.
It'll simplify everything if there are no options coming in. You know, but I anticipate there will be the same one that was voted no should come in, because the real estate agent's going to submit it to make his real estate fee again, you know, if the town would purchase it. So I think that one will be there. And then there was some talk about the front of Five College Farms, which is the Rose Gardens.
Mushroom place now?
It's tomatoes.
Tomatoes, okay.
Yeah. So that's a possibility. I don't know. It could be hypothetical too, and just a rumor. I don't know.
I forget to ask you folks. That presentation, I think we should limit it and prepare it for either a 30 or 40 minute max time, not an hour or 2 hours.
Right.
No, yeah. Shorter.
Short and sweet.
Right. So, you know, we can work on that. Okay. What do you want to discuss next with this project? The outside appearance of it? What we can maybe go visit other departments, other stations, try to, you know, either get pictures of it or what to bring it back? I think we should be looking at what the outside design of this building is going to look like. You know, what we would like to see in it, you know. Mm-hmm. I mean, maybe you got some different ideas.
Could we invite engineering outfit that develops pre-engineered buildings to come in and speak to us what it would involve as a speaker to the committee? It might be beneficial.
Well, we can maybe talk to Frank Quadro on that and see what he can drum up,
which would be good, I think,
for pre-engineered buildings. Is there any way you can talk to chiefs within in Western Mass? And you know, I have no problem taking a ride anywhere and either taking pictures of it, you know.
Yeah, I visit other chiefs quite frequently, so I can snap some pictures and take some pictures of in interiors with mezzanine.
I still really like the appearance of that Belchertown building, that brick veneer front end. I don't even know where that picture disappeared to, but it just,
that's worth taking a tour of.
Well, he was there. That was his.
Yeah. It's a nice building. It's put together well, and it serves. And Belchertown is the biggest community in Commonwealth of Massachusetts. They have 63-plus acres, and that is their only station in Belchertown.
All right.
They don't have any substations anywhere.
I was going to ask if that was a substation or if that was their main station or only station.
It's a main station, but this one we're proposing is almost the same size.
You know, I mean, this is scaled down. You're going to find stations much bigger than this and what, but, I mean, you can scale it down to any size that you want.
Perhaps before you look at what the building might look like, you might look at other fire stations that are within the center of their historic districts, because that's what this is going to be. And that's one of the reasons that Greenbaum was given the okay to buy the building, was that he was going to restore it and restore the outside and make it into an apartment building that still fit with the historic building itself. And if we're going to put another building right next to it, it would also have to, or should probably, conform at least to that kind of planning.
That's a good point, I think. If there's out there, Chief, any fire departments that had to build in a historic district, and that would be a great place to go see how they handled it.
We could always probably go and look on pre-engineered buildings and see what buildings were built in historic districts, you know, that are built now, wherever they are in Massachusetts, you know, so.
Did you go to Great Barrington?
Yeah.
Where is that? Is it right on Main Street?
They have two stations, but yes, I believe it was on Main Street. Yep.
Okay. What do we want to put on the agenda for our next meeting?
Well, did you want to put on, he suggests the pre-engineered structures, possibly having somebody come in to discuss that?
Yeah, we can ask that. Right?
Mm-hmm.
We'll ask Frank Quadro like that. He deals with a lot of folks.
I don't know when you're thinking of having your next one, but I can try and compile that list of stations in historic districts and then also ones that are outside of it, just other options. With some pictures.
I have no problem taking a ride. What about you? Do you have a problem taking a ride? We can take pictures of it.
Probably a Saturday would be better for me, like most people, if we could make an arrangement with these fire chiefs and get them to be there and speak to us at the same time.
Yep.
You know?
On a Saturday, they don't have no problem doing that.
I'm sure that they would be willing to do it if we gave them enough advance notice, because most of them are full-time.
It doesn't make any difference.
Most of the departments you're talking about have full-time staffing, so that they're full-time anyways, unless they're at a call.
Okay, what else do we want to address on this project?
There was something about meeting with Mr. Yushko. What was that? I was just reading down.
With who?
Yushko.
Yeah, Willie went to visit him with the plan about the boundary.
Yeah, because, he owns all of that, right?
Right, the boundary agreement. Willie said to me there shouldn't be any problem at all with them. And he met with that Laura Fitzgibbon, and she has absolutely no problem. So the only one left with this church, and, you know, we met with him today, so he's going to talk to the folks there and probably invite us down so we take the map and everything and show them.
And the church boundary is a direct straight line
from
the road to their bound near the lake, and then it takes a left there, so it's a straight line.
There's big stones.
Big stones that they had put in.
A pin or anything. When do we want to meet again? Week? 2 weeks?
It's asking you to do a lot in a week.
Yeah. I mean, it's up to you, but did you want to, I mean, if the group wanted to go visit some of these stations too, we could actually have a, you know,
aren't
if
you
the group
on
wants
vacation
to go.
Somewhere?
In August, yeah.
August, what's your date?
15th through the 20, 8th, I think.
Could we schedule it before he leaves, a couple days before?
Well, I just...
Would that be ample time?
Why don't we do 2 weeks?
Yeah, I agree.
2 weeks for a meeting?
I don't have a calendar.
Then you're gonna be...
21st, 28th.
28th of July?
July 28th.
You don't need me, but I'm leaving on vacation on the 20th.
July 28th, and that location's gonna be here, or...
That here is good.
Or Richard wanted to set it up at, Town Hall.
If you want to have your meetings aired, it'd be a very good idea to hold them over at the Town Hall. There's a lot less setup time for me or for Miranda.
Does everybody have, nobody has a problem with that, so that, I think it's...
Thursday night open over there?
Usually, I think, right? Availability Thursdays?
Usually.
The 28th on a Thursday?
All we gotta do is mark it on the calendar upstairs.
You're gonna take care of that?
Right in the meeting room.
Are you gonna take care of that?
And we're talking 7 o'clock?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's July...
28th.
28th.
You got a key?
Yeah.
Perfect.
Tell two of them.
All right, so you're gonna check with places. I'm gonna take a buzz over to Belcher Town, so maybe you can just give them a warning. I'm done.
Oh, gosh.
Oh, gosh.
They'll have a police escort at the live.
Did you want me to ask anybody on the department or the association if they have experience putting together a webpage, or did you just want to use the town webpage? Did you want to...
Who does the town page?
Basically, the departments. There are certain people that have access to it. Jennifer...
Yeah, it's set up so that you can just add sites to it.
Oh, so there is no one person that's like an overseer of all the things, to try to put the things... Now, that's why it's so disorganized.
Would you get more coverage if we used the town? Could we have that map back?
Well, you can link it.
I think it'd be easier.
Oh, this is the only one you got?
Yeah.
You're right.
The thing is that you could link it, though. You could have something on the town website where they can get the information, but then you could have a different webpage that gives you more information on it, so you're not filling up the... I mean, I don't know, where would you put it on the town webpage? Under whose department?
Select Board. I mean, we're ad hoc committee of the select.
Right.
That's the proper place to...
Right.
It's just sometimes people don't see that, so unless it's on the main page, we'd have to figure out how we could clearly identify where you go and make sure it's in that side banner or the banner across the top.
We can do that in the...
Yeah.
Why can't you make your own webpage, too?
You can.
Would it make any sense?
Creating a webpage is very costly.
Actually, no, it's, you can do it for free. Some of our kids are very good at doing that, and I can ask them, and I don't think there is a cost.
Would it hurt anything to go both places?
Well, then you'd have to have somebody on the committee that is talented to input it into the webpage, too. That's another factor we have to look at.
I'll ask.
You know?
Doesn't hurt to ask. See, if it's no cost, if it's not a big deal, then...
Okay, so you're gonna bring that information back?
I will ask, yes.
To the next meeting. Is there anything else we want to put on for the next meeting to talk about?
You were talking about the folks that don't have access to computers, and did you, I mean, what's the policy for putting stuff into the water bills? Could we put a trifold together on it, or no? For public information, or no?
Why don't you talk, you're the water commissioner.
Yeah, it's a public information sheet. Anything can go in there. It doesn't matter, but may change the cost of the envelope sometimes if you overload it, you know, but that would be something we'd have to talk with the collector or...
I think in there would be good is to put in a place to call the people to call and bring their message, their question.
The senior centers, their monthly flyer or bi-monthly newsletter?
You know, you're a contact for the fire, and the police chief's the contact for the police. You know, if we need other contact, you know, you can put another contact in it.
Yeah, I don't know about putting it in an official town thing like a bill, because we're not official. It doesn't quite sound legal somehow. Maybe you could answer that.
We're official, it's just that we're not quite to a point.
Yeah, it hasn't gone to like the town meeting. It hasn't been approved. I wouldn't want people to say, well, you know, you've got somebody on the town behind you, and you're trying to weasel in before town meeting, you know.
No.
I'm just thinking of all the paranoid...
I think the key is informational.
Informational.
If it's informational, you're okay. If it becomes promotional, that changes everything.
You can also leave it at Town Hall and just tell people that it's available at Town Hall.
Yeah, but not everybody goes to the Town Hall either.
I understand.
Right.
Yeah, I agree with you, Don. You know, if you cross that line into promoting something.
Right.
You know.
It's just like.
It's not promoting, it's asking people to respond and ask any question they may have, be positive or negative.
Right, but you're using the town's envelope that they send out their bills in. In that sense, you know, the town is putting their stamp of approval somehow on it. Literally.
We're seeking information, be positive or negative, you know. I mean, they don't have to sign their names to it. Because the only people would be getting them is the people that are mailed to.
Well, I think we got a ways to go before we get to that point.
Right.
Well, I think we need to talk about all this and plan all this and schedule it when we're actually gonna take action on it.
I just know how quick time flies and then all of a sudden it's.
You know, you take 2 weeks off here, a month there, and then here you got town meetings.
We could be dead in the water on the 12th.
Correct.
We don't know. The other thing I think we should put on the agenda is preparation for ZBA and planning meetings discussion. We have to plan ahead for that.
Mm-hmm.
So that should be on in 2 weeks. I think it would be a good time to start with that.
Well, let's put that on there, right?
Howard, are you are doing the minutes? If you want, we've been doing the agendas here. If you want to just send us what you have and we'll make up the agenda again. And then we ship it to Jessica for it to be posted. Are you writing down what's going to be on for the next
agenda? Can Karen type out those minutes that he's got there?
It's totally up to you. If you want her to, she can.
I'm sorry, say again.
You want someone to type that stuff out for you?
No, I can type it up.
Okay, you got an opportunity. Don't complain.
I understand.
Right.
Might affect your golfing.
All right.
Not much affects that.
I guess I'm just asking, do you want to do the agenda, because he asked us to do it, or
ZBA.
You want us to do it?
ZBA and planning board discussion to bring forth our proposals.
Yeah, that's what I was asking.
Enough said.
And the reasoning behind them.
Planning board discussions, testify. Okay, that'll be on the next agenda. Is there anything else?
Have site visitation on there, right? You put that on
there.
I got
that.
That's written down.
And what?
Site visitation that the chief is going to be looking into. He'll bring in that to next meeting for discussion. Is there anything that we want on the agenda, seeing that the police chief wasn't here, that we could have him explain further to the general public?
Yeah, let's
like the fire chief did, maybe he could come and explain why he's talking about these areas in the communication center and police facility.
Let's assign him to something he don't like to do, seeing he's not here to defend himself. Some nasty job. No, I imagine maybe he'll have time to come next
I'm sure he will. I said, we worked a.
You know, he's very much interested in this project. You know, I sat down, I talked to him today.
But he's tired. He worked all day yesterday, and we had a meeting till almost 11 o'clock that ended, and it had to be continued, a disciplinary hearing. And both him and Sergeant Cook had long days, and Sergeant Cook was out directing traffic at 5:30
all right.
This morning.
Is there a motion for adjournment?
I make the motion to adjourn.
Is there a second? There's a motion made and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Meeting adjourned. And thank you, Richard, for your time.
Yes, you later.